Okay, here we are. Talking Racine is back. And this evening we have Mr. Jim Spodek, our producer, Mr. George Meyer, our special guest, and Mr. Ken Lumpkin, our resident authority on things governmental, former county board supervisor. I'm Dr. Ken Yorgan. I want to bring you up to date a little bit on some past episodes, some past business. We have submitted some open records requests, which I'm sure those of you who watch the show regularly are aware of. One of them was for documentation on some of the things that are going on down at Machinery Row. Well, there's nothing going on down there, but some of the things behind the scenes, some of the manipulation of money and so on and so forth. Anyway, we've submitted a request for some of the records, and we were told that it was going to cost a certain amount of money and take a certain amount of time, and we were able to recover or gather together some of those documents without assistance from the city. So we have now resubmitted a much slimmer request. Also, we've gotten some inquiries as to the shooting of the bulldog over on Kearney Avenue when there was a no-knock warrant or served over there on a family. And the dog was shot. And it's not the first dog that has been shot in Racine. People are pretty upset and they want to know what's going on. Well, we had submitted a records request to the police, and they basically told us that those things were not available and we could not access them. But we've checked with the laws and we found out that there are things that we should have access to, so we should be resubmitting that probably this week. All right, now, and we want to invite, you know, it's kind of a crowded podium here with four people, but we're inviting all of the aldermen to come on the show and talk if you want to discuss any of the things that we talk about on the show and explain to us what your opinions are and why you're doing some of the things you're doing.
I'm glad to give up my place if all my work.
Did you hear that? George would step aside.
We get a couple aldermen, I'll step aside.
So today's show is going to focus on the Development Department of the City of Racine and the Redevelopment Authority. And they are different things. I don't completely understand them, so I'm going to be the guy asking questions of the people here that are the experts on these subjects. Who would like to explain the hiring of Amy Connolly, City Development Director, who came on board recently to replace Brian O'Connell? We have a volunteer?
Well, I first heard of it when she was in the process of being hired. I got my information through the newspaper, and it sounded relatively innocent. She was touted as being a person that was in a bit of a turmoil down there in Tinley Park, but it looked like it was mostly political stuff, you know, how you throw things right around like that, and for political reasons she became like a political football, and she was really innocent. There were no charges made or anything like that, whoever vetted her or whoever decided it, I don't know, it was the mayor or whoever it was, presented her as being a possible person, and I think she made a little presentation at the council meeting, and she was elected in relatively quickly.
And we've looked at some records from Tinley Park since then. It turns out she was pretty much a flashpoint down there. I mean, there was...
Yeah, it turned into a... we did a little bit of research on it, and, you know, one of the things I think that really came to play in Tinley Park was the fact that she changed an ordinance to adapt it to fit a development that was to be put in downtown. And that kicked off a firestorm in Tinley Park. And, you know... We could show a clip and then kind of get an idea of what we're talking about, and then we can come back and...
Because there were some people really irate. There was a big town meeting demanding her removal.
Yeah. Absolutely.
This was not just a little political football thing.
Right. And it's interesting how that correlates with Racine. So this is where we're going to kind of go with this, but let's the clip.
Okay, let's take a look at it right now.
Okay.
Residents of Tinley Park discovered that their village had allowed an out-of-state company, the Buckeye Community Hope Foundation, to plan to build this 47-unit low-income housing project. The deal was a mere 48 hours away from fruition when citizens got wind of it and showed up in droves to tell the village that they wanted a say in the future of their community. A big mystery surrounds Amy Connolly, planning director, who seems to have used her position at the village to allow Buckeye in through the back door, changing a text amendment to the code to allow access for Buckeye to be in precise compliance. Connolly was placed on fully paid administrative leave, angering many citizens.
What happened to laying her off and letting her collect unemployment like everybody else has? She should be officially laid off until further notice and collect unemployment.
One thing I do want noted by the trustees is that the civil servants who are employees of our town put us in this position. I am a business owner and I have accountability in my business. Someone needs to be held accountable for the dilemma they've created and the lack of trust that now exists between you and us. Because I will tell you, there's none.
She's shrouded in mystery, in my opinion. There's so much baggage with her. And hopefully one day the truth comes out about Amy Connolly needs to resign right now.
She's a menace to Tinley Park. She needs to be, you know, again, removed from any public position because she flat out can't be trusted. I can't even begin to calculate how much money that she has cost this village. You know, parachute package for her or whatever, or take your money and get out of our way. No. You should be fired immediately. Not one more cent to her. And that's it. And if you want to go back and try and sue us for a wrongful termination, fine. We'll play that game. But for right now, I am sick that my tax dollars, any of them, are going to her. It makes me ill.
Okay, well, it looks like the people of Tinley Park were a little upset with Amy Connolly.
That was amazing. More than just a political football there. This woman had raised the ire. Can you imagine something like that going on in Racine? I haven't seen anything like that. No. Where these are everyday citizens. This isn't a street rally of some sort. This is people coming to the council in outrage, saying, get rid of this woman. The closest we've seen to that was when Act 10 came in and a whole bunch of people came in because they were worried about their pensions.
But they actually
there was no demand for removal of anybody. Right. It was just an objection. You've seen that. But this was, I've never, and
well, it was
I didn't
far,
imagine
far more
something.
Than a
and that was just
football.
A bureaucrat. Yeah,
well,
somebody.
And I just wanted to bring, you know, one of the things up. When it was put out and I went back and looked at the Journal Times, Racine Journal Times article, and when I read that article and I looked and we did a little research on what actually happened in Tinley Park, boy, those are two different worlds. I mean, I don't know who wrote that article, but they missed the boat on that. It was absolutely, matter of fact, they quoted her attorney as she is the most honest and upstraight person and, you know, wouldn't do any. I mean, you know, I'd kind of laugh. I watched her quote her mother, you know. I mean,
and it turned out that she actually surreptitiously changed a city ordinance.
Correct.
Which is, that's really malfeasance.
Well, it was malfeasance.
Well, and it was put through without a public hearing.
Without a public hearing and no vote. I mean,
right.
Basically,
so that was more than just she changed a little word, and there was a public hearing, and nobody noticed the word was changed.
One word, and it changed the entire development project that they were talking about doing down there.
Right, but yeah. She didn't even go that far. She somehow managed to get it through, so there was no public hearing at all.
Right.
Yeah.
And then what happened was the development company, after it went through, decided, hey, we got this through. If you don't give it to us, we're going to sue you. So now this little village is stuck with a potential lawsuit, a threat of a lawsuit. Absolutely,
yeah.
A potential lawsuit on something that, you know, she did incorrectly or bypassed.
Why would we bring somebody like that into the city of Racine? What possible motivation could there be for bringing a person of these qualities and qualifications to our community?
It seemed like the people of Tinley was draining the sewage.
Draining the sewage.
And we got the byproduct.
We're downstream, is that what you're saying?
We got what was left from. But the thing I'm concerned about, and I go back to the alderman, I have a problem with the fact that here it is, you're going to be replacing a department head, and you just have one candidate. You
right.
Know, yeah, I think that any city that's going to be making an investment, bringing in somebody that's looking to make changes in the community, et cetera, that they should have had more candidates available. And the aldermen themselves should have, demanded that that happen.
You know,
this seemed like an altogether new process.
Well, she was sanctioned or suspended in February of 2015. She actually was released from her position in May of 2015, and 4 days after she was released from her job, she started in Racine.
Mm-hmm.
So how much real vetting was done? And this stuff is available. There was 40 or 45 episodes in Tinley Park on this whole
yeah,
40 episodes like the one we saw?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a woman down there that does kind of a video.
Megan Fox is her name, yeah.
Yeah.
She's
well,
got
what
a number.
What would you call it? I guess a video report?
Kind of a talking Tinley Park.
And what does the Redevelopment Authority actually have control over? What are they in charge of running and supervising?
You know,
there's money involved, right?
Let's go back a little bit to Machinery Row, and we had that episode on Machinery Row. You had the chart out, and we all talked about Machinery Row and the intergovernmental revenue sharing account. That, again, was monies collected from Mount Pleasant, Caledonia, Wind Point, Sturtevant, monies from the water department selling water to these municipalities.
Right.
We were collecting. I did a little numbers. I broke down from 2006. I couldn't go back any further. From 2006 to roughly 2015, we've collected over $15 million in fees from those communities.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, I just got up to 2013. We've collected almost $7 million from Mount Pleasant alone. So this money is generated into the city of Racine, but it doesn't...
That's from that water sale agreement, right?
About okay. $1.5 million a year, looks
okay.
like.
Even more. In some years, it can get up to almost $2 million. Mm-hmm. The thing about it is, that doesn't go into the general fund. The Redevelopment Authority, which is... a separate, for no other words, it's a separate company set up outside of the city of Racine.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I just want to make, just bear with me a minute. I want to put a clip up, and it's Dave Brown from the finance department being questioned by QA Shakur at the budget hearing in 2015, asking those exact same things. Where is it in the budget? Where is this money in the budget? So if you guys bear with me, we'll go to that clip.
Okay, we'll go to that right now.
But I do have one, and maybe it's out of order, but where's the RDA? Would it be under this budget or no, or Racine Development Authority?
We've prepared an RDA budget that the RDA looked at their last meeting, but I don't believe it's part of this package. Mm-hmm.
Is it?
The RDA is actually an independent body separate of the city. They have their own taxpayer ID number. They are not a part of the city budget at all. They stand alone. They get the majority of their funding comes through the city, but they are an independent organization. So you will not see them in our budget document.
So do we... Am I understanding you correctly? Do taxpayer dollars go there or no?
There is no levy directed to the RDA, no. The majority of their funding has been advanced from the intergovernmental shared revenue account and through TIF districts, but there is no tax levy directed towards the Redevelopment Authority.
Thank you very much.
Okay, we're back, and it's probably a good idea to clarify the difference between the City Development Department and the Redevelopment Authority. And Amy Connolly is in charge of the City Development Department.
She's an actual city employee. This Redevelopment Authority apparently is an independent, according to Dave Brown, an independent private company to which this water money goes, the $1.5 million up to $2 million from Mount Pleasant, wherever it's coming from, and it goes into a private corporation. It's not staying within the government. Goes outside of that. Amy Connolly is over here in the government, right? And money goes over to the Redevelopment Authority. A bit confusing because they use similar names.
Yeah.
Now, the Redevelopment Authority have a board of directors. Maybe you can explain how those members become members of that authority board.
Right. Now, they're a separate board.
Not elected.
Not elected. You have to look at the members of that board, and I think we'll do that in another episode. But those board members control that intergovernmental sewer money. Now, they go to the Common Council on occasion to basically tell them what they're going to do. Amy, though, the employee of the city development, is now putting a budget together. So you got to take it for a minute here and say, we have a board, an unelected board, who is now has a budget from intergovernmental. They don't have to answer to the city development. They don't have to answer to the alderman. So now when you say, how can an arena, how can Machinery Row, how can these different things that Amy Connolly wants to push forward with the direction, I'm sure, of the mayor, how does that happen without the interactions of the representatives, aldermen, and the taxpayer? Now, let's just show a clip of Amy, where she wants to go with our...
Oh, this is her latest initiative.
Right. Now, this was the budget. This was the budget back in 2015. So this was already on the slate back, well, we're in February, so this was back 5-6 months ago. So let's take a look at this clip, and then we'll come back and kind of...
Comment on it?
Yeah.
Okay. Here we go again.
We have to continue to make investments in our capital budget to support development that will attract more investment to our community and show investments in the city of Racine. Our capital budget shows investments in several different areas of the city. We have capital plans in place that have to be executed. Machinery Row, West Bluff, the Root River Promenade, the Metra Extension, Racine Steel Site, and of course the Event Center project. These all need planning and they need implementation. Our capital budget reflects the need to implement these projects. We have to remember that a budget is just a plan and a lot of things have to line up before we can see progress in areas, but we do plan on moving forward with many of these projects this year. And just so you know, before this year, the RDA had never had a budget. So we're trying to make sure that we're more clearly allocating what we're doing to make it more clear and transparent for you.
Well, basically what she did there was say that there from now on they're going to have this money set aside strictly under the control of the Redevelopment Authority. What she read was a resolution from the Redevelopment Authority. It amounts to like $825,000 this year. And they're going to set up their own budget, and every once in a while they're going to tell the council what they've been doing it with, but they don't feel any obligation to do so. It's just kind of like, you know, we got this money over here, and every now and again we'll tell you what we're doing with it. And so there is no representation of the taxpayers involved in the expenditures that are coming out of that account. It seems...
Well,
Dave Brown said, this is not tax levy money. But yeah, when it comes right down to it, it's money that's coming from the citizens. It's not just falling out of the sky.
Well, it's not tax levy money technically because it's coming from the payment of water bills.
Right.
Your water bill is not considered a tax levy, even though it goes to the water department, which is a department of the city of Racine. Still not considered a tax levy, so he's correct in that. But it is taxpayers' money. But he's you know, using this term, it's not a tax levy. No, it's not, Dave, a tax levy, but it's still taxpayers' money, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And apparently it is because it's taxpayers, like the money coming from the cable commission that goes into the general fund. No, it's not a tax levy. It's part of your cable bill, but it's still taxpayers' money because it was money we put into our cable bill and some of it went towards the city.
Right.
Well, but what's interesting to me is that she is over in the city development. The city redevelopment. Let me get these names. City development and the department. Redevelopment authority,
yeah,
is not part of the city, but she is as a head of a department in the city of Racine is planning the budget for this private company. Have I got that right?
You're absolutely.
That's
right.
What she promised. She
right.
promised a budget from this private company as the head of the governmental. The city of Racine.
Exactly. But there's nowhere where they have to actually come to the city and really discuss what they plan on doing.
Well, it sounds to me like what they're doing is they're putting up a ruse. It's kind of like we're coming to you. We don't have to come to you.
Right.
But so that you don't start questioning too much what's in this budget, we're going to pretend that we're listening to you, and so we're going to at least report to you what we're doing.
Yeah,
but we're doing it whether you like it or not,
right.
Because we really don't need your
opinion. And to clarify that idea that it's not taxpayer money, it was taxpayer money that went into building that water department into what it is today.
Yes.
So
yeah, absolutely,
it was in our water bills. They've told us for years our water bills are really high, but it's going in because we have to do something about the purification program.
So we built this profit making center,
uh-huh.
But we're not allowed to really take part in anything to do with the profits. The profits are going off to this.
I was looking forward to when they started selling that water to Mount Pleasant. I thought, wow, this would be great. We'll get a reduction in our water bill. We'll get all that money back.
Or taxes or something.
Yeah. And then I find out, no, we're not getting any of it back. That's going into.
Well, here's one of my points too is we collected $15 million. What do we got?
Mm-hmm.
What do we got for $15 million?
Machinery roll. Complaining, Jim.
Would I be correct in looking at this as a $800,000 slush fund?
You know what I'd call it? The Mayor John Dickert's private development company. That's what I would call it.
Okay.
He says right here, Mayor John Dickert's real estate development company.
Okay.
There you go.
Because where is it? I mean, really. And you don't have to go.
There's
to the,
proof.
You don't have to go to Machinery Row. I mean, all they had to do was go to the Common Council. If the Common Council would have rejected that amount to buy the Zarian Marina and the rest of Olson and all, they could have done it anyway.
Apparently, if it's coming from this redevelopment authority, that's exactly right.
Yeah. I mean,
it has its own tax ID number.
What happened to our common council?
We know from their manual, we've read it on this program, they are the governing authority.
Right. Using a sports term, this is an end around.
Absolutely. This is an end around. It's been going on for a long time, and now they brought in a number one quarterback to run it.
Double reversal.
Yeah. When this thing was set up originally, when all this money was coming in from the water project, and there's a few dollars coming in from other areas, but when it was all set up, it was given very, very vague definition. And I think basically it amounted to, we're going to spend it on things to improve Racine.
Yeah, right.
Well, but then it's put under the auspices, or it's put under the control of some people who have their own idea about what improving Racine is.
Well, we won't get to it in this episode, but I think the next episode, we start looking at that board. And who's on that redevelopment authority that is in control of this huge amounts of money?
Yeah.
And who's there?
Yeah. I like to see, and probably will work with you guys in coming up with some research to talk about what have happened with this money over the years. You know, we're talking about the 800 and some thousand now, but how was that money used? I think this whole money came about 15 to 16 years ago. So where have that money been going to in the past? And I think that's important that we look at that, and maybe we can find out what it should be used for. I'd like to see the original agreement at that.
Yeah.
Well, correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems to me that you just volunteered to do some research.
Yeah, sure.
Another thing, gentlemen, that I'd really like, and we pushed on this before, we brought up with the manual, I brought up in this meeting, is I would like to really see this money get put under the auspices of the Common Council. That's where it belongs.
Yeah,
they must be responsible for it. Let's at least get that changed. Let's abolish this corporation on the side.
Right.
And it goes into some department within the city under the council's control. That's where it belongs.
Yeah. This money should not be willy-nilly to a separate company. The Redevelopment Authority needs to be abolished. Totally, 100%. Those dollars need to be brought into the general fund, the city of Racine, controlled by the alderman and the taxpayer.
When the heck did this go into operation anyway? Whose idea was this?
You know, I've been looking back, and I've gotten so far, but I can't seem to find the actual date that this started. And if it's got a tax ID number, we can find it.
Maybe the dog ate the homework.
Well, yeah, there's some. But
Well, let's see. We got another video here, don't we? We got a.
This is a woman.
This is Megan Fox. Right?
Yeah, this is her. This is one that we did. She did a lot of videos in Tinley Park, but I guess we'll just end the show with this, huh? But she comes out of one of the meetings similar to what, and this is just really just this is Tinley Park. This is Amy Connolly down in Tinley Park, and she just kind of spells it out. You know, how did an unelected group of people control what's happening in Tinley Park?
So do we want to actually close the show with that? Maybe we should.
Let's close the show there.
Next show, we'll have a breakdown of the members of the redevelopment board. So thanks for being here. We hope to see you again real soon. And stay tuned. We're going to show this clip of
enjoy
Megan Fox.
Clip, yep.
And enjoy this. All right. Adios.
Anything like it. I've never heard of an elected board abdicating its responsibility to an unelected volunteer commission who then just does whatever they want without any input from the elected officials or any input from the community at all. So now the board has no power to vote on this project that nobody wants. It's crazy. They've given away their power. That's nuts. I've never heard of anything dumber than that. I don't even think that's legal. Can an elected board give away the power the people gave to them to represent them to that one woman or a board of elected of non-elected people? Who knows? Well, somebody has a like you said, a personal agenda here.